I invite you to stand, open the 1982 hymnal, and we will sing hymn number 150, 150. At home, we're on page 355. It is the fourth Sunday in Lent. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one,
have mercy upon us.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious Father, whose blessed Son Jesus Christ came down from heaven to be the true bread which gives life to the world, evermore give us this bread, that he may live in us and we in him, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Almighty and everlasting God, you hate nothing you have made, and forgive the sins of all who are penitent. Create and make in us new and contrite hearts, that we, lamenting our sins and acknowledging our wretchedness, may obtain of you, the God of all mercy, perfect remission and forgiveness, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the readings.
A reading from Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus. You were dead through the trespasses and sins in which you once lived, following the course of this world, following the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passions of our flesh, following the desires of flesh and senses, and we were by nature children of wrath, like everyone else. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read the first song of Isaiah in unison. Surely it is God who saves me.
I will trust in him and not be afraid. For the Lord is my stronghold and my sure defense, and he will be my Savior.
Therefore you shall draw water with rejoicing from the springs of salvation. And on that day you shall say, give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Make his deeds known among the peoples. See that they remember that his name is exalted. Sing the praises of the Lord, for he has done great things and is known for all the world. Cry aloud, inhabitants of Zion. Ring out your joy, for the great one in the midst of you is the Holy One of Israel. Glory to the Father, to the Son, to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be. Amen.
I invite you to stand, open, lift every voice and sing number 54. Lift every voice and sing 54.
Yeah.
Holy Gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ according to John. I'm reading a different gospel than is on the screen. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." Jesus answered him, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished with what I have said to you. You must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." And Nicodemus said to Jesus, "How can these things be? Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony." The Gospel of the Lord. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Having been on large staffs as a Christian educator for 20 years, I assumed, and you know what that word means, I assumed that when I finished that I would be doing, because of my interest in social justice, that I would be doing urban work in a big church. Well, I've spent my career in small churches helping churches redirect and grow. But one of the things that happens when you live in a small town is very similar to poor Nicodemus. Wherever you go, whatever you do, people know where you are. And on occasion, I have had people come to find me knowing I would probably be in one of three places, so that they needed some attention and they found me. But if you went to a store, had your hair done, your nails done, went to the movies or whatever, someone would say, "So-and-so saw you there, so-and-so saw you there." And so I feel sorry for Nicodemus, because Nicodemus comes to see Jesus at night. Nicodemus doesn't know it yet, but he's looking for belonging, meaning to his life, and purpose. He knew if people saw him, that there would be ramifications. For you and for me, Jesus is a big deal. But in the world of Nicodemus, he was the big deal, the bigger figure. He was well known as a Jewish leader, and it would have been embarrassing for him to be seen with this Jesus, or to have people think he needed help with a religious question. If Jewish leaders were upset with Jesus, he did not want to be caught on the wrong side. I wonder how many nights Nicodemus thought about coming to Jesus before he did. How many nights he would run the questions that he had through his mind. How many times did he start out and then turn back out of fear? And finally, he had to come. Something inside of him wouldn't let him rest until he saw Jesus. This sense of longing to belong, this searching for meaning and purpose, wouldn't let him go. That's really what new birth in faith is like for most of us. Some of us have a dramatic moment that we can remember when we were born anew in faith or accept Jesus into our hearts. And for many of us, me included, being born anew in faith has been a long walk with God. There are moments of God's presence that move us, and there are lessons that we learn slowly. But it is still the road to belonging, meaning, and purpose. Nicodemus finally worked up the nerve to come to see Jesus. He started with a little flattery, and Jesus dropped right into it, a discussion about God. And by the time the conversation ended, his mind was spinning and he probably had a big headache. He came to Jesus as a prominent figure, a prominent religious figure, and Jesus told him he had to be born again. Well, that was just fine with the birth that he had. He didn't think he needed to be reborn, thank you very much. Sounds like the way the Episcopalians act about being born again. Thank you very much, but I've already had my birth. He would have fit right in. In Nicodemus's world, birth set your status in the world. People who study ancient Israel tell us the honor derived from one's status at birth was simply a given. It usually stayed with a person for life. So to be born again, born for a second time, would change all of that. Thus, a second birth, especially if it differed substantially in honor from the level from the first birth, would be a life-changing event of staggering proportions. It is unthinkable for Nicodemus. It's not that Nicodemus was slow to grasp this with his questions. He was stalling for time. He had a lot to lose because he had been the center of attention, the prominent one. But the craving, that inner yearning for purpose, kept nagging at him. I've been Nicodemus a few times in my life, and I would imagine some of you would agree that you too have had that yearning, searching for belonging, meaning, and purpose. When I go to a baby shower for my friend's grandchildren, and people ask for a bit of parenting advice, one thing I say is that you have to become a parent to the kid you actually are given instead of the one you planned for, right? I did not see how much work would be involved in doing that until I had my children. Each one, even though they were of a different gender than the other, one was a girl and then I had a boy, they had different issues, so the surprises were ongoing. And both of them were very different than their father nor me. I thought I knew how to be a reasonably effective parent. You know, you balance love and structure, the importance of family, nurturing talents, each one that the child has. There were gardens and summers where they had book lists to read so their brain didn't go mushy, and math lessons, in particular for my daughter, who could keep it going so she didn't forget the year before. You know what a big hit that was. First couple of weeks, they could read any books they like. I didn't care how thick they were, but they reached a point, if they didn't read so many, I would decide what books they read, which of course got bigger and bigger and bigger. So they got in the incentive to go ahead and get going. So as you know, I was a real big hit. But the reality is my children still do this now with their own children and now their grandchildren, to see that they keep them motivated when they have these off months. Are you searching for meaning? Are you looking for purpose and belonging? Maybe it's learning to be born again after the reality of cancer, death of a spouse or a dear friend, a new job, retirement, moving to a new place, a new marriage, or dealing with your friends dying. Maybe you're being born again, trying to figure out how to live a sober life. An author by the name of Glenn Doyle tells a story in a book called Love Warrior about hitting a low point in her life as a young woman. She had already been through a lot, an eating disorder at 10, drinking heavily by 13, and time in a hospital for mental health by 17. She said she had had a happy childhood, which added to her guilt about why she was in such a mess. As she often says on her blog and in her books, by college, she was a full-blown alcoholic, grabbing a beer soon after she got up and even taking it into the shower with her. Feeling awful about herself, one night she stumbled into a church to make her confession to the priest. On the way into the confessional, she found a small room that was warm and safe, with a smell of incense, and in that room she felt less alone. She tripped on the carpet, and so she took off her shoes, letting her feet sink into the carpet. The softness was comforting. She saw a huge painting of the Holy Mother, Mary cradling her baby Jesus, with a tender, compassionate look on her face. She looked at Mary, and Mary looked at her. And she knew that even though she was a mess, inside and out, Mary loved her. She had this sense of belonging. Then the priest came in, and for a moment she felt afraid. He seemed tired, exasperated by the depth of her problems. He folded his hands and he listened to her. She shook in the bright lights, and because she was cold, it was worse. And as he looked at her, she knew she looked like some kind of a junkie. "Which I am," she said, "but right now I'm just cold." He told her she could have been forgiven if she repented and said she was sorry. In the small room, God felt like a mother to her. God is an administrator. She told the priest that she was sorry, and the priest let her go with a feel of disdain. The disapproval was expected, but this surprise feeling of belonging, of acceptance and warmth from Mary, was something that she did not anticipate. She cried all the way home, not because of the priest, but because Mary saw the good in her, and she recognized it. She thought, you know, I feel sad but real. Mary saw the good of me trapped inside of me, looking for meaning and purpose. That means the good is real. We all have to be born anew, born into our own goodness, into a new world of faith. Born into new ways of being the church. Born into connecting with people outside of our walls. We have to be born into a God who calls us to be and into the life that we have waiting for us. And we are not alone in this. We are born from above, and the Holy Spirit blowing where it wants to is our partner in this. In every sense of the word, as we yearn for meaning and purpose and belonging. Miss Doyle said that the moment in the church of her childhood and the power of sitting with the Holy Mother reminded her of a moment she had in her early childhood. The ice cream truck came to her neighborhood. And while the man in the truck was selling popsicles out of the window, a teenager had broken open the back door, and he was handing them out for free. The owner couldn't see him. There was a short line at the window and a long line at the back door. The Holy Spirit is like that teenager, handing things out. Not recommending theft, certainly, but the free gift that's offered to us, we just have to be ready to receive it. The Gospels don't tell us much about Nicodemus, about the gift and how he got it, but he appears two more times in John's Gospel, most poignantly when Jesus died. He came and prepared the body for burial. He had learned to do the hard work. He had been born anew and joined the light of Christ. He found his meaning and his purpose, and he didn't care who knew it. My brothers and sisters, may we be born and born again and again into the life of God's Holy Spirit. May we live with that joy of the Holy Spirit and see good, the real truth that is within us. And may we continue to deepen our faith as God's people and remember that there is always work to be done as we grow in our understanding of our meaning, our purpose in life. Amen. I invite you to stand and join with me as we recite the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. The Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. We believe prophets. We believe in one holy and Catholic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. You may be seated, stand, or kneel for the prayers of the people.
O God, from whose eyes the measures of our faith is not hidden, rent from us now all religiosity, all rules and regulations from our scheduled selves that separate us from your Holy Spirit. O God, who calls each of us by name to be the church, give us love enough to make a difference. Give us vision enough to follow. Give us endurance enough to hold steadfast in the face of the unholy. O God, who claims us as disciples, bless us now and touch us with your holiness, that we might have your commitment enough to be good news to the poor and all who suffer this day. O God of the bruised, we pray for healing. Comfort those who cry in dark corners, the lonely, the strangers, the weary, the fearful, the disappointed, the anxious, the depressed, the forsaken, the dispirited, the grieving, and those who lie in sickness and in pain. O God, who wept over Jerusalem, open our eyes to those around us who scream in silence the depth of their despair. O God of compassion, heal our hard hearts to tenderness. O God of oppressed, fire us the justice that we might proclaim liberty to the captives. O God, who gave us the rainbow and the part of the Red Seas, we dare to pray for miracles for the powerless. O God of the hungry, we pray for those who have not bread. Remove, O God, the bondage of hunger by removing our shackles that we might share bread. O God of the homeless, we pray for those who have no land. We pray that you will open the doors of our hearts and let your wandering people in. O God of the captives, have mercy on those who must live out their lives enslaved to someone else because of race or politics or economic or faith. Loose our bond that we might risk our own securities on their behalf. O God of peace, give peace to our hearts, to our nations, and to our world. Confession of our sins. We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father.
In your compassion, forgive us our sins.
No.
Things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit that we may live and serve you newness of life to the honor and glory of your name.
Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Forgive you all of your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
Eucharist is offer the glory of God and thanksgiving for Jesus Christ and for all of us who are seeking meaning, purpose in our Savior, Jesus Christ. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
And lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
God of all power, ruler of the universe, you are worthy of glory and praise.
Glory to you forever.
At your command, all things came to be. The vast expanse of interstellar space, galaxies, suns, the planets in their courses, and this fragile earth, our island home.
By your will, they were created and have their being.
From the primal elements, you brought forth the human race and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the rulers of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust. And we turned against one another.
Have mercy, Lord, for your sin is in your sight.
Again and again you called us to return. Through prophets and sages you revealed your righteous law. And in the fullness of time you sent your only Son, born of a woman to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace.
By his blood he reconciled us. By his wounds we are healed.
And therefore we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope, to proclaim with them your glory and their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And so, Father, we who have been redeemed by him and made a new people by water and the Spirit, now bring before you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord. The night he was betrayed, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering now his work of redemption and offering to you this sacrifice of thanksgiving. Lord God of our fathers and our mothers, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength, for pardon only and not for renewal. Let the grace of this holy communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name. Accept these prayers and praises, Father, through Jesus Christ, our great high priest, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit, your church gives honor, glory, and worship from generation to generation.
Amen.
And for the season of Lent, we say the Lord's Prayer in the modern version. As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on them in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. As we remain seated, lift every voice and sing 183. As we remain seated, lift every voice and sing 183. Please stand. For our friends at home, the post-communion prayer is on page 366 in the Book of Common Prayer. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son, and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Look mercifully on your family, Almighty God, that by your great goodness they may be governed and preserved evermore through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and those you love this day and always. Amen. Please be seated for the announcements. Orlis, we're very grateful that you're here today. I'm grateful all of you moved your clocks forward. I know about you, a little sluggish here today. Oh, well. Buddy.
Food Pantry had a very successful event this week. I want to start off by thanking Lou Ann for a very generous donation and helping us feeding us Thursday and Friday by supplying some goodies from Simply Sweet. It was very nice. We had 115 folks. Mm-hmm. On Friday. It's down a little bit, but it's moving up from 105 the previous week. So thank you very much.
Appreciate it.
One other thing, if you all, in lieu of plastic bags, if we could get egg cartons, the 6 and 12 egg cartons, we're low on those again. We don't ask for those all the time because normally when we ask for them, we get a ton of them and we have them for a while. So thank you for your generosity.
So egg cartons, so you're saving egg cartons because we have fresh eggs that come as a gift from someone and they wash them and then they put them in the cartons for our guests. It's really wonderful. Today our class, our ongoing class, will be meeting in here after they get their food. What we are going to do is describe and go through the mysteries that take place at the Holy Eucharist. Now, if you're interested in just dropping in to be part of this for the moment, get your food, leave it outside the doors on the tables. You can leave it on our class tables. Nobody over there will steal it. And then we will discuss what we've learned here back in the Ricker Hall. So if you're in line and someone says, I'm going to the class, please let them go first. And that way we can get this portion of the class done in a reasonable amount of time. Our Bill, and I know he's watching us, so I'm going to bawl him out. Do you know what Bill is doing on the cruise ship? He's playing the organ or the piano for the services. Naughty, 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 Bill. I'm telling you, he doesn't rest. All right, our closing hymn, verses 1, 2, and 4 in the blue, in the 1982 hymnal, 427, 1982 hymnal, verses 1, 2, and 4. Let us go forth to serve Christ by welcoming all, transforming lives, and growing the church.
Thank you. something about giving music to Kay?
Did they invite you?